I'm glad to have a technocrat. So Sudakshina is a digital business and industry director at SAP. She's an expert in emerging technology domain, example e-commerce, both B2B and B2C, digital marketing, Internet of Things, and big data enterprise analytics, and is engaged with customers to jointly define digital enterprise strategy that enables business model transformations. She's also industry 4.0 lead for SAP India. Thanks a lot, Sudakshina, for being part of this session. The floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Deepak, and you know, for inviting me and giving me this opportunity to talk about technology in farming. And it was an interesting discussion. I was listening in to especially the usage of technology in dairy industry in particular. I do completely and wholeheartedly agree with the fact that, you know, just technology doesn't solve the problems. We actually need to, you know, ensure that it reaches the beneficiaries who need it the most. So with that, let me start with, you know, the topic that I chose to present here today. And this is a topic that is, you know, very close to me as a professional, you know, focused on the consumer and agribusiness industry here at SAP in India. So what I wanted to talk about today is the, you know, the need for digital farming and what are some of the, you know, critical digital farming applications. So that is what I wanted to talk about. I would largely keep the context in of my conversation focused on India, because you know, that is the market I'm most familiar with in terms of you know, an understanding of the challenges and where some of the gaps are. So with that, let me quickly take you through the agenda. Over the next 20 minutes, we would talk about a brief overview of India's agriculture sector and then place it in the context of Vision 2020 that the government of India has put forward for this sector. After that, we do a little bit of deep dive into the agri value chain and talk about some of the challenges. And then we go into, you know, how digital farming and some of the applications that are available today can help solve some of these challenges that exist across the agri value chain. And towards the end, I also have a few, you know, customer examples that I would like to leave you with. So with that, I'll just get started. So let us talk a little bit about the, you know, agriculture sector here in India, an overview. This is across, you know, crop and livestock, right? However, some of the data points that I have here are related to crop yield. So of course, no one can deny that for a country of 1.3 billion people, agriculture is indeed our mainstay. With the growth in population, is agricultural productivity keeping pace with it? And not just productivity, but also meeting the changing demographic requirements of the consumers. So that is the basic premise with which we should look at the sector. Agriculture does account for a significant part of India's GDP when we compare it to manufacturing and services. While India is largely a services-driven economy, manufacturing and agriculture actually account for a significant part of our GDP. India is globally ranked as number two, just in terms of farm output, and whether it is, you know, wheat, a lot of the animal produce like milk, etc. You know, we are global leaders in terms of just the sheer volume of the output, and it is also a big generator of employment. The rise in wages of farm workers is not showing a very great trend compared to workers in the manufacturing industry or the services industry. Yet, this sector provides employment to a huge part of the population of our country. Another challenge is that farms, and this, Ashna Singh was also talking about, is that the the smallholder farmer. So that also leads to certain challenges when it comes to scale, when it comes to adopting technology, investing in technology and driving outcome, because there is a certain cost that goes into investment of technology. However, if the farm size is too small, which in India it averages around 1 hectare, and this is really, this is really many, many times smaller compared to farms in China and in the US. And these are some of the other large, agricultural producing countries. So that is a big challenge in terms of the small farm holdings and also the crop yields. While a lot of focus post the Green Revolution has been in terms of driving productivity, however, the crop yields at an overall level continue to be low compared to the global benchmarks. And even if we look at rice and wheat, which where we are leading across the world in terms of the volume of produce that we actually are able to generate, yet the productivity is fairly low, both in terms of the rice yield and the wheat yield. So with that, let us also now understand that, what is the government's view on this? So there has been a shift in focus in terms of where we are looking at agricultural interventions. So far, post the Green Revolution and the White Revolution, which is focused more on dairy production increases, Historically, large-scale agricultural reforms in India have been geared towards driving production. Whether it is through the application of fertilizers and application of other technology, the focus has largely been in terms of driving production. And we have seen great strides that our country has made, as a result of these policy interventions. But they have led to also certain outcomes, which we will talk about in the next slide. But here, let us understand now how the mind shift and the interventions have shifted, right? So now the focus is more on improving farmer incomes. And this is largely because of the declining wages. If we compare it to a service sector worker or a manufacturing sector worker, and also the hard conditions due to limited mechanization, there is a move away, from farms to looking at employment in the cities, right? So improving farmer incomes, focusing on building the linkages and the supply chain infrastructure that is necessary to ensure that farming is a profitable endeavor and employment generator for the nation. So that is what we are focusing on. And this challenge becomes amplified because most of the farmers in India are smallholder farmers, right? So any intervention that we talk about has to be something that they can adopt and generate quick ROI from, right? So keeping these contexts in mind, the focus increasingly in future is going to be changing the mix of the farm produce. So moving away from just producing rice and wheat, which are procured by the government at minimum support prices, moving away from there to a better mix of the farm produce, that will fetch farmers better prices, right? And also looking at better storage mechanisms through which the produce will last longer, building better market linkages so that quality-based incentives can also be provided to farmers. So these are again certain key areas where policy is focused on, government interventions are focused on, and a lot of technology interventions are coming actually in these areas, right? So even before we talk about the technology interventions, let us talk about some of the key drivers that will lead to this vision of doubling of farm income by 2022. So some of the key drivers are the focus still remains on productivity, because that is definitely a challenge that farmers, whether they are crop farmers or livestock farmers, face, right? And you just saw the global benchmarks in the previous slide. So productivity continues to be a focus area for us. And we need to look at, definitely technology interventions in driving productivity. Also technology interventions to ensure that resources are used efficiently. Largely a lot of the production a lot of the farming that happens in India today is hugely dependent on groundwater, right? So how can we ensure that irrigation facilities or irrigation leads to is the utilization of water resources is maximized? Similarly, how can we ensure that labor that we deploy for farming activities is highly productive? How can we ensure that by minimizing wastages, such as fertilizer application or water use, we are able to bring the overall cost of farming down? So that is another important driver. A couple of other things which I mentioned is not to just look at producing of crop twice a year, but to increase cropping intensity by again changing the mix. Same farmland, but how can we change the mix of the crops that I'm producing as a farmer in a year rather than two rice crops or two wheat crops that I produce in a year, right? So that is also going to be a key driver. I mentioned that, there is a move towards high value crops such as fruits, such as vegetables, especially organic produce, that for which there is increasingly the market is increasing in urban areas and also internationally as well, right? So that is another key driver. And to ensure that, instead of selling produce at minimum support prices at the nearest mandi, how to connect farmers to larger procurement networks, or to ensure that agribusiness and consumer products companies who are into, say, food products have direct linkages to farmers and can incentivize the farmers based on the quality of produce and also to some extent the farming practices. If the farmers have adopted sustainable farming practices, then can we provide them better pricing for that? So these are all the various areas which we need to focus on to achieve the vision of doubling farm income in the near future. So let us now, talk about some of the challenges that exist today across, the agri value chain, right? So let me first start with the agri inputs, which includes seeds, fertilizers, pesticides that go into the early stage of the farming process. Now, some of the challenges here are, of course, the heavily resource-intensive farming practices that we adopt, especially when we are cultivating rice and wheat, utilizing groundwater as the primary source of irrigation, right? So this not only just stretches the water resources, the soil quality also deteriorates because of, applicability of fertilizer when we are not entirely sure about what is the right amount to apply, right? Similarly, pesticides, when applied, without consideration or without properly understanding the kind of pest infestation that has happened, or pesticides just sprayed across without being able to pinpoint the area where the pest infection is the most severe. All of this leads to severe deterioration of soil quality, which makes the productivity of the farmland gradually declines over a period of time. Right. So these are two big areas which require urgent intervention. The third area, of course, is just getting crop insurance. Now, the adoption of insurance is minimal. It is actually less than 1/4 of the gross area cultivated is under insurance. Right. There are lots of challenges around getting insurance. That is because, it is typically a labor intensive process. The agents would have to go and actually check the crop, check the quality of crop, understand the quality of the farmland to be able to get a sense of what is going to be the actual final yield. All of this is difficult to do if, for a country as diverse as India with varied farming practices, right? So all of these are areas that have challenged the broad-based adoption of crop insurance practices. Going to the next part, which is cultivation and farming practices. Again, here farmers lack access to credit at affordable rates, again, because of the same challenges that I just spoke about, which hinder the adoption of insurance. Also, farming practices are antiquated. They are largely based on historical and also, a ground level wisdom that rains usually come at this time of this month. So we usually plant, at this time of this planting cycle. Now, with climate change being a reality of our lives, the weather patterns have changed. And this typical historical wisdom based on which farming and cultivation is done today, that needs to change as well based on better access to weather, rainfall, soil moisture data. So this is another important element. The third thing that I wanted to talk about here is, of course, which I also spoke about in the earlier slide, is the changing consumption pattern. So the future demand is coming from areas such as fruit, even fruit that is not largely grown, for example, pomegranate, right? So that is a fruit for which demand is expected to accelerate going forward. Similarly, pulses, with India's changing demographic and larger parts of the population moving out of poverty, becoming middle class, pulses demand is increasing so much that despite India's production of huge volume of pulses, we still have to import pulses from other countries, right? And this trend is expected to continue. If we are not able to improve the pulses production or to reduce or are able to reduce the spoilage, then we'll have to keep importing pulses from other countries. So again, these are important pointers to note, and also vegetables, not just in terms of potatoes, but a whole host of vegetables, and also organically grown vegetables is another key area for which the market is just developing right now, but the development is going to accelerate in the near future. Poor farm mechanization, as I mentioned, there's a lot of focus still on, using just manual labor for farming practices. And this needs to change in terms of just using equipment for various stages of the farming process. Poor mechanization is also a challenge when it comes to harvesting our agricultural produce. Similarly, during the harvesting phase, there are a lot of middlemen who come in, and farmers actually sell to this middleman, and that also sometimes lead to price asymmetries. For this, better market linkages need to be put in. Again, the productivity, the cost of farming is also going up because, as we see this trend of labor moving from villages to urban areas, just getting labor for that time periods when farming activity is at peak is a challenge. So again, that leads to higher wage costs as well. So for all of this, farmers need to also borrow money on a short-term basis at very high interest rates from local money lenders, which also impact the productivity of small farmholders. From a storage perspective, warehousing infrastructure in the country is not that well developed, and this presents a huge opportunity for areas such as providing value-added services in warehouses, providing cold chain, building the cold chain capacity, and ensuring the quality standards are maintained in the storage facility. So these are all important areas where both infrastructure and infrastructure interventions are required. Farming practices need to change, and only then that will help us somewhat, address the price volatility that tends to exist in the market. Similarly, from a marketing perspective, lack of price transparency across India as an integrated market, or when I'm looking at international markets for commodities, that is an important area which needs urgent intervention. And there are multiple intermediaries in this process, which sort of reduces the price that is realized by the farmer and increases the price for the end consumer. So any simplification of this go-to-market part of the value chain will lead to better outcomes for both the farmer and the consumer. Similarly, transparency and traceability are important areas where, the end consumer wants to know which part of the globe, the produce is sourced from, what has been the carbon footprint before she buys it from a retail store. So these are all emerging areas, but they are important as we look at agriculture of the future. Similarly, food processing is becoming an important area of where both in terms of, you know, where India has some advantages and which can be a big employment generator in future as well. So with that, now let us look at what are some of the biggest areas where digital farming can play a role, right? So first is obviously the first part of the value chain, which is in terms of giving farmers better access to agri inputs so that their yield and productivity can improve. Similarly, we can augment farmer knowledge with and help them with more understanding of through data, through which they will be able to improve their productivity practices rather than relying on what they have been doing historically. That brings us to precision farming. Precision farming are specialized inputs that are provided to farmers that are intended to provide insights into what is the right time to sow based on the data and weather patterns. Other advice in terms of agronomic and irrigation related inputs can really help farmers to not only drive productivity in future, but also they are able to forecast what their yield is going to be. And this will help them in the next step, which is to get access to loans, right? And banks or NBFCs can look at this data remotely. So they can look at the crop quality in the early stages based on images that farmers are uploading, right? Reducing the need for a person to actually go and inspect the crop in the field. And based on this image analysis, the lenders will also be able to make an estimate in terms of the forecasted yield. And based on that, the entire loan disbursement process can actually be significantly streamlined. Again, the same process can actually be used for crop insurance. So, for example, if a crop failure has happened due to a pest infestation, again, the same claim settlement process can be significantly streamlined by uploading pictures, satellite imagery, or geospatial imagery for the field, right? So, again, these processes can be significantly streamlined and the cycle times reduced. The other big area that is emerging is just in terms of equipment sharing. So that will drive farm mechanization. Instead of me as a small landholder farmer having to buy, having to spend significant amount of capital in buying equipment that is going to help mechanize some of the, you know, farming and harvesting practices, what I can do is I can be part of a digital asset sharing network. And, you know, one center can serve about 300 customers within a 10 kilometer radius. And the same equipment can be lent out to multiple farmers, right? So this is definitely something that, the government is also going to enable. And a lot of companies who are in the agri equipment manufacturing space like TAFE and Mahindra are working in this area, right? And even sensor-based analytics can be done to ensure that the equipment doesn't fail in the field. We can prevent that before time and also use sensors embedded in this equipment to gain further information about the soil quality, moisture levels, etc. Similarly, when I move to marketing and trading, here largely we are talking about networks and marketplaces that connect farmers, help them understand what the prevailing prices are so that farmers are able to get the best price for their produce. From a processing and retail perspective, the biggest area of focus is in terms of just looking at the quality of the produce and driving further automation in the food processing industry. And through just these digital interventions, there is a significant scope of adding approximately, 50 to 60 billion US dollars to the GDP by 2025 through some of these digital interventions. And this is as per McKinsey Global Institute's research estimates. Now, let me talk about, what are some of the key applications that can support this entire agri value chain, right? So, there are things, emerging technology platforms like the agri inputs marketplace. So this is a marketplace where as a farmer, I can go and buy whatever I need this particular round of cropping, whether it is seeds, I can look at and compare various qualities of seeds. I can look at fertilizers. I can also access the best practices for fertilizer application, understand the yield difference between different fertilizers provided by different companies, look at pesticides and what is the best application procedure for these pesticides. So this is something that a agri inputs marketplace can deliver. And this can also be a marketplace through which I can access finance, whether it is insurance or loan, and agri inputs marketplace can deliver those. There are other areas like just managing my farm operations, doing the planning, tracking the equipment, that can also be digitally enabled to a large extent today. A couple of other areas are, these are largely the agricultural contract management, again, comes largely from the point of view of consumer products companies who are in the area of producing food or doing food processing. So these companies can get into long-term contracts with farmers through which the farmers are able to guarantee a certain, certain quantity that they would be able to deliver to these companies. Companies can purchase in bulk and hence they would be able to get better prices, give better prices to farmers. And also if farmers are able to deliver consistently on, in terms of time and in terms of quality, then it becomes a long-term win-win relationships between farmers and companies. So this is another interesting area. In terms of just the farmer management and building these connects, especially with rural farmers, are again other interesting areas that are emerging. Similarly, commodity management, looking at the overall pricing trends that are prevailing across different geographies, especially for grains, coffee, tea, etc., and also for dairy and meat. Based on that, again, contracts can be created, and all of this will help farmers gain better prices. Other areas are related to warehouse management, cold storage management, logistics, just the planning of the logistics activity, right? And so all of this are hugely technology driven areas today. Similarly, a connected agriculture platform will be able to provide precision farming, smart farming inputs to farmers, and a produce marketplace will enable more buyers to connect directly with sellers, eliminating the intermediaries. Similarly, track and trace in terms of being able to trace the produce back to its source, and also to ensure, and this, some of this is largely blockchain driven as well, through which I'm able to really go back to the source, see how the produce has traveled through the supply chain, also go down to understand what has been the carbon footprint of this particular produce. Other important areas, and these are largely related to, the livestock industry. So whether it is meat processing, feed processing for cattle and poultry, and dairy processes, things like milk balancing, depending on the fat content of the milk, how do I align the production processes for the milk? As SAP, we work with a lot of customers. A lot of the agri transactions actually pass through an SAP system. So we actually are working with a lot of companies on all of these areas. The next way I want to quickly talk about is this emergence of networks. So from a linear process where a farmer takes input such as seed, fertilizer, and farm equipment, and then grows the crop and then stores it, processes it, and a company buys it. Then from there, from this linear process, we are going into this age of network where there is visibility provided at different points of this value chain. Right, so how does that work? In the network view, the key pieces of technology that play a role are, of course, these networks and platforms and digital marketplaces, the emergence of edge computing and IoT technology, and the agriculture applications that I just spoke about, right? So a lot of companies are working in this area, whether it is Monsanto, who is a global commodity, agri-commodity company, two companies such as UPL, which is one of India's largest fertilizer producing company. InVivo is a cooperative in France who are investing a lot in smart farming technology. Similarly, Sime Darby is an agri company based in New Zealand. These are some examples of customers where we are doing a lot of this work in terms of grower identification and enabling them with the precision farming inputs for them to adopts from the smart farming practices. Companies such as Nestle are actually getting into these long-term sustainable farming practices with farmers so that they also get visibility into prices, and they are able to plan the long-term procurement against demand better, working collaboratively with customers. I mentioned Mahindra and Cafe, who are creating these massive asset sharing marketplaces to drive further farm mechanization. Similarly, ITC eChopal is a very, very established example in India. And Cargill, again, is one of the large global companies who are investing a lot in this farmer training, giving them access through an app on a mobile device through which they can exchange data with agri marketplaces, with other customers, do transactions with banks and with consumers through mobile payments, right? So this is largely how this network vision shapes up. And, I already spoke about this. AI technology plays a great role in some of these areas, whether it is soil health monitoring or crop health monitoring, or ensuring that farm mechanization is done in the right way. Obviously, precision farming is dependent a lot on artificial intelligence-driven algorithms to generate the advisory, do crop selection based on crop types, depending on weather data, and to actually accurate yields and give indicative pricing. Similarly, artificial intelligence-driven algorithms are playing a big role in crop insurance and farmer credit assessment as well. So these are some of the AI-related use cases that are also playing a huge role in the adoption of digital farming. So just to end it, I just wanted to talk about a few selected examples of innovation that we have done with our customers. One is through a grower portal, we are actually nurturing a community of farmers, whether they belong to the remotest, farming communities in Africa, growing coffee or cocoa, connecting them through a portal and offering them value-added services that I mentioned, such as loans, insurance, agri-input, and smart farming input. So that is one big area of innovation where we have lots of examples across the globe. Marketplace, of course, where the quality can be assessed based on AI algorithms that look at the images that have been uploaded, and farmers are given an indicative price or a trend of prices through which they are able to sell their produce better, and buyers are also able to place bids accordingly. Track and trace is largely being driven by blockchain, whether it is a provenance, that is tracking the origination and the quality of the crop, or used for giving loans and insurance, and also to a large extent streamlining the export documentation process for produce that is exported to many different countries who have different standards. And just to end this, I just wanted to give you some snapshots of how this actually looks. So if you have your piece of land, you can take a look at the soil quality, you can take a look at how your equipment has been deployed. You can also take a look at the fertilizer application that has happened and the electrolyte based transmission of that fertilizer. You can look at and zoom in into areas that require specific, more care rather than just spraying pesticides across the field. So this is something that we are doing with customers today, even going down to the extent of being able to identify one single palm tree and doing specific interventions around that tree. And all of this, of course, is very seamlessly meshed with weather data to be able to make any of these predictions and projections. So with that, I come to the end of my session. And if there are any questions, I can take that, Deepak.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks a lot, Sudakshina. It was really awesome to hear from you. Would it be possible to stop sharing the screen so that audience can see you?
Yes, of course.
Perfect. Yes. Thanks a lot. That insightful session. In fact, there were some comments which were coming on social media to me. Mm-hmm. And you also that nailed it well. They were looking at we are looking for solutions, right?
Sure.
And suddenly I was just going to comment back that just have some patience, and suddenly I can see complete blueprint of how digital solution can work in agriculture. So very well articulated. So there are a couple of questions from mm-hmm. our side as well as a couple from the audience. First question from the audience side is that actually we talk a lot about digital technologies, but there has been seen that especially in case of South Southeast Asia, that scale up has not happened. So what are your views on that? Why there are like, you know, not the solution, which is, for example, like, you know, 10 million or 15 million farmers using a type of solution.
Right.
So your views on that.
Right. So a couple of points, and very, very valid point, Deepak. And, you know, we talked a lot about this in our AI for AI World Economic Forum work group as well. The challenge that we are seeing is twofold. One is, of course, we do not have enough data, right, to be able to build scalable models that will enable true smart farming and generation of insights. We have data in pockets, and we have, by pockets, I mean a certain crop type grown in a specific region. For example, growing groundnut in a specific district of Telangana. In this sort of small pockets, the AI models have been found to be very effective, to the extent that the models have been able to predict what exactly is the right time for you to sow the seeds, so that the yield will be maximum based on the weather pattern. But what we have to understand is that, you know, the variety of soil quality across our country, the farming practices, the different types of produce that is grown in the farm, when you mesh all of this, the complexity increases manifold. So one of the biggest areas that the government is working on today, and a lot of other institutes, academia is working on, is just to create these open data sets based on which the agritech companies and companies like SAP and others would be able to create these scalable insight generation model through which we will be able to give meaningful, inputs to our farmers. Largely today, I do agree that things have remained on a pilot basis, but I am sure that within the next few years, once more and more of this open data sets come into use, this challenge of, you know, this the smart farming or the precision farming insights being highly localized will be addressed.
Very well articulated. And I fully agree that lack of data and the silization of the data is one of the big challenges in agriculture. Yes. And then also the type of varieties, like, you know, you're talking about just maize, 200,000 right. different varieties.
Right.
So all that makes with too many parameters. In fact, in my own experience, right. I was able to identify close to 208 parameters which impact your yield.
Right.
And all, each of these parameters have its own, the set of data, which goes, as I give you an example, variety itself is 200,000. So yes. when you do it, like, you know, you're talking about a huge number of data and that's all.
Right.
Second question, again, very interesting question, that do you see possibility of AI bias?
Yes, of course. Some of the recent, last time we did a few very interesting pilots in terms of, just the bias. Now, I'm not talking about, so for example, let me talk about bias in the context of loan. Right? Would a woman farmer, and since this is women in agriculture, would a woman farmer get a loan or be denied a loan depending on, you know, her credit history or the lack thereof? So that is one question of bias definitely that we need to look at. Similarly, bias, I wouldn't say bias, but in terms of just the availability of labeled data on produce quality. You know, last year we were doing a few interesting pilots with some of our customers, and just to understand the quality of a tomato or a cabbage, the amount of labeled data that we need to, you know, actually ensure that it's a different variety, and hence this is not a it's not a indicator of bad quality, but for this variety, this is the right quality. That challenge again boils down to the availability of data and availability of good labeled data based on which we are able to build our algorithms and train our models. So this availability of good labeled data is definitely a concern, and we do struggle quite a lot in just building very small. So we keep reducing the scope of the model in that case, you know, for this particular variety grown in this particular soil type in this particular farm, in farms of this particular region, instead of trying to make the models generic. It's a challenge, of course, and we have to always be very conscious of building in bias, because the sheer variety of crops that we produce in India is huge.
Perfect. Now, my next question, I'll just a little bit preface it to give the context. right? If we buy any product on the market off the shelf, right, you would be having the total calorie content, the protein content, and all that.
Right.
Now the challenge is that, like, you know, they are all based on some standards. If 5 kg of wheat is used, then the kilocalorie is this. But actually, myself being practitioner on the ground, right? Believe me, how you grow that wheat, it will define how much calories or carbs or, like, you know, or other nutrients.
Absolutely, you're right.
Do you see that the traceability market can address these challenges?
Yes, absolutely. So what we are seeing, especially with the large companies, say, you know, who are in, who source agri inputs and produce foods, processed foods especially, there the entire recipe and label management is a big area. And there the traceability, especially driven by something like blockchain technology, where this information is encoded for them to be able to actually be more accurate when they are printing the label on the product. So that as an end consumer, I have a better understanding rather than a generic label based on generic quantities, which are not really tied into, you know, the real practices that have been adopted in the field. So this entire label and recipe management, especially in alignment with the guidelines, the emerging guidelines and evolving guidelines of, say, FSSAI in India or other regulatory bodies across the world, is a big area where we are partnering with customers to define what will be the next, what should be the process in future.
Now, last, very interesting, but I'll say that little bit of naughty question, right? It is by one of the audience, actually, the WhatsApp us, my team. The question is that just like any other sector, now is EdTech will also be cannibalized by SAPs and IBMs of the world?
Actually, I think this is, it's not a naughty question. I mean, I think this is a very fair question. And with our model right now that we're doing is more of a partner-driven model, especially in these innovation areas, right? So we are open to partnerships. We will provide you the technology platform. We can provide you the connects with customers who can give you, their challenges, their business problems to solve. And Deepak, maybe we do a hackathon at some point, and take a few of these problems and see how we can solve them. Definitely. See, innovation is it's interesting. It's dynamic. The breathing heart and soul of innovation is the fact that we need more and more people in the network for real true innovation to happen. So companies like SAP and I can speak for other tech companies as well. It is more of a partnering model with agile innovators, who really bring in the true right solutions to the problems rather than, trying to solve all of this ourselves. Like agri marketplaces of the future, innovation marketplaces are also the future.
Super answer. That will give a lot of confidence to a lot of startup founders who would be, like, tuned into LinkedIn and Facebook and YouTube. And guys, just a small update. We just crossed 750 unique viewers on our social media platform. So it is taken pretty well. So that's great news, and definitely I look forward, and we will talk about it. Let's do a hackathon with really top 100 startups. We do have access to them, and then let's give them the problem and use some of the innovative technology you talked about to solve them. So thanks a lot for an awesome session and sparing your time. I know you are having a super busy schedule, but sparing some time for Women in Agriculture Web Summit, it would add a lot of value to ecosystem. Thanks a lot.
I do completely believe in the cause, Deepak, and wish you more success in future. Thanks. Thank you.
Thanks.